and then have periods of dry down between the irrigation times. I mean, simulates if you can water down and then let that top foot dry out, kind of pulls the root down. We would do that with a lot of our vegetables as well, trying to drive the roots down. If you always keep that top 12 inches saturated, yeah, they'll stay. Mm-hmm. They'll stay where that is.
But I find with other camellias, that the pH that you define, I find is too acid. And I've worked well with around 6, or a little higher than 6.
Yeah, anyway, most of ours is like 5.3, 5.5, which we've had good success with.
And we also do a 5 foot wide spacing with a 1.5 foot in row spacing. So if we're trying to establish commercially for a hedge production, we're going to give it 5 feet in width and then keep it shaped to that 5 feet wide. As you can kind of see, it's gotten a little bit wider than that because we were letting it get a little big. And then in row, the density, we've even heard as dense as 1 foot in between each plant. But you can give it a little more space too.
Is there a lot of work in maintaining?
Yeah, to keep the shape. If you're trying to keep it in a tabletop hedge formation, which we can talk about during the processing phase. Did you have another question about establishment?
Do they pair well with any other plants, or should you keep them isolated from other plants?
You know, people have asked us about companion planting. I don't honestly know how to answer that. I'm sure they would. I mean, they're a beautiful evergreen, so they would grow. I think they're beautiful in like an edible landscape setting. There's a lot of people who are interested in that. Edible landscaping, but in terms of like companion planting and like beneficial root exudates and all that, I don't know anything about that.
There's a lot to be said for how Rosa rugosa grows as far as watering, so, you know, water being in the plant and the roots gonna be. But I found that like mixing them in, and I don't recommend that because Rosa rugosa trails out and gets in the way of everything, but they do real well with that kind of watering schedule. Mm-hmm. So they'll go dry, a little bit dry anyway, before growing in the plant. They're, you know, like you said, once they get a little bit established,
yeah,
second or third year, they're on their way.
Yeah, I mean, there's sections, we've had sections that we've never watered after they've been established, so, you know, like second or third year, more like third and beyond, you could generally, at least where we're at, we can get away with not watering them at all. It's just the same, gets to the same question of what are you growing them for? Are you growing them for maximum yield of leaf or not? And then if you are, then yeah, giving them a certain amount of water will definitely drive leaf production to a certain level. What we've done, yeah, we've related to organic matter. I did skip that. When we established ours, some of our plots, we spread a line of compost, you know, about 2 feet wide and tilled that in prior with a little sulfur in as well, and tilled that in and then planted right into that. And then depending on the weed pressure would be mulching it with either leaf compost or sawdust. So, yeah, is there other establishment stuff, or should we talk about tea?
Yeah. Let's talk about tea.
Talk about tea.
Yeah, so there's Camellia sinensis, and then there's the finished tea plant. So this is by far the most challenging, mysterious, complex aspect. We come from an agricultural side. We're not necessarily food artisans. And I love tea, but I'm really loving tea more and more and trying to really develop my palate, because making good tea, you have to know what good tea tastes like, what it looks like, and there's such complexity in the processing world, especially within certain styles of tea. So I will use this little diagram. I'll pass this around so you can see a little bit of the leaf, which is really helpful. I do have some info sheets up here. One side is basic plant care and the other side is basic processing. And if they run out and people want more, you can sign up for our newsletter thing here, and I can send the PDF to you. So we are doing very basic styles right now of finished tea. So I'll talk really briefly about the different types of finished tea. So you have white tea, which is picked, often withered, and then dried. So it's very close to the natural state of the leaf. There's probably a very small amount of oxidation that's happening because the biochemical activity in the leaf, something's always happening to the tea leaf once you pick it. but there's no oxidation in terms of like the oolongs are black that creates that dark tea liquor in white tea. So it's completely unoxidized. Then you have your green teas, which go through a fixation period. It's sometimes called kilgreen. So traditionally it's either steamed, like in many of the Japanese teas, or there's Chinese methods where you're pan firing and doing wok firing, and you're essentially heating the leaf so that you're killing all of those active enzymes in the leaf. And then you roll it and shape it. I'll start passing this around. Does anyone want to start with this? So you can see this leaf here that we picked last night. And in white tea, pretty much in all teas, though sometimes the wither phase is not very long, in all styles of tea, the tea leaf goes through a wither phase. And you can see that's what's happening with the tea leaf on this tray. The withering stage is essentially where the tea leaf is losing moisture. There is biochemical and flavor compounds that are formed in that, but the loss of moisture in the leaf is allowing it to be pliable for processing. So if I took that leaf, if I took fresh picked leaf, like these two little, you know, two leaves and a bud, which I'll talk more about the part of the plant we pick in a bit, but if you just take the two leaves and a bud and you started to roll it and shape it, the leaves would actually break because there's too much moisture content in the leaf. So the wither stage.
It's just not pliable. It's like you can actually, you know, hear the leaf crack when it's fresh before it's wilted. When it wilts, it turns almost leathery. It gets really pliable.
Yeah, you can feel those leaves there. They're definitely in a wither stage. So in the green teas, you're picking it. Sometimes you're letting it wither, or sometimes you're going directly into that kilgreen stage, either steaming or pan firing.
But they do look different.
Shaping the tea leaf. So we do that by hand right now. There's machinery that does it. This really beautiful towel I brought, we get these muslin flower sack cloths, which are very low in lint, and they're just the perfect size, these squares, to do the hand style of processing we're doing. So for instance, in the green tea, we would steam it. We're using big bamboo steamers. It's not a traditional tea piece of equipment, but it's what we're using right now. We're going to hopefully be getting some awesome machinery from somewhere. I'm trying to research that right now. But so we usually do for green teas, we'll do about a pound at a time. So we'll take a pound of leaf that's been freshly steamed, we'll put it into the center of this tea towel, wrap it up in a ball as tight as we can, and start to roll it. And so that's going to shape the leaf. And that's what you can see in this really pretty, I love the tea ball once it comes out of the cloth. I think it's so beautiful. So that's expressing moisture from the leaf, which is going to help it dry down eventually, and it's shaping it. So the beautiful hand-rolled shape that you see in lots of the artisan teas, that's either done by hand traditionally or done with machinery. And then you're putting it in we use a very low convection oven. We do about 125 degrees for 20 to 30 minutes. Sometimes we'll take it out every 5 or 10 minutes and, you know, move around the leaf. People have asked that a lot. If you can get your oven low enough, there's no reason to use a dehydrator. And at the stage that you're putting it in the oven, you're actually wanting to stop any biochemical activity. So you might be able to make a unique tea in your food dehydrator, but it is going to be, that's not traditionally how it's done in the tea world. Usually at that point, you're trying to get all of the moisture out of the plant and stop that, most of that biochemical activity.
Which I think, depending on the tea, it might just take too long, where you're wanting to arrest the oven, like arrests it within 30 minutes versus it might take, you know, a day in a dehydrator.
I just use your oven on the lowest temperature you have, but be careful not to cook all the moisture out of it, because we've actually learned that, and our fellow, 20 to 30 minutes, 125, Balaj here is one of the fellows that we've worked with processing tea. He processed vast majority of all our teas getting started, and he taught us to cure the tea at that final, like once you want to get it to about 10% moisture, is that correct? 8 to 10?
At which point?
At the time that you're taking it out of the oven, and then we put it.
How do you tell that?
But you can weigh it at every stage. So we actually do, when you get into the really technical aspects of doing tea, the amount of moisture loss from the withering stage to the point at which you're actually processing it can be very critical. So we weigh our leaves at almost every stage, not every single time, but in this initial learning phase, we do that quite a bit. And that way you know your percent moisture. So you'd be able to know your percent moisture at that point. So then we cure it in these big plastic bags, and so we'll open it up every day, fluff it around. And I have read recently, World of Tea is an amazing online resource. Tony Gubley has just such fantastic articles, a lot of scientific depth. I've read that there actually is additional flavor compounds that can form during the curing phase. So it's important not to just dry your tea so that it's bone dry. You want to have, I think, 2 to 3% moisture.
I think it's 3 to 5.
3 to 5 in the final stage. It can mold though too if it's not dry enough. That's happened to us. So don't do that. So green tea, white tea, green tea. Then you get into your oxidized tea. So oolongs are a semi-oxidized tea, so it's an enzymatic oxidation that's happening in the leaf. In oolong teas, you are very lightly breaking the cell walls, and often you'll see traditional methods where the tea is rolled in these big columns, and the leaf is just sort of falling on itself over and over again.
Like a giant open dryer.
Yep.
It just tumbles.
Just tumbles, exactly.
Yeah.
And so the pressure of the leaf falling upon itself, and then you let it sit, you can see oftentimes a very light perimeter oxidation around the perimeter of the leaves, and they call it the dancing of the leaves, oolong sometimes, or traditionally. And anyone who knows about any of these processing phases can jump into, because there's lots to share. So yeah, you'll see oolong teas are usually in a range of oxidation, so oftentimes you'll see the percentage of oxidation on different oolongs. And we've found it to be the most complex style of tea. And tea processing is an art. There are tea masters who maybe have been making tea their whole lives, or people who've been making it their whole lives and would never even be called tea masters. It's an incredibly complex art, like winemaking. So we're at the very beginning.
You may have already covered it, but I still don't know. What is a tea flush?
Yeah, so let me finish with black,
okay,
and then I'll get to it. I should have started with that.
Sorry.
Should have started with that. That's fine. So then black teas are fully oxidized. So in the black tea world, there's two main types of tea. There's the CTC, which is cut, tear, curl. So that's when the leaf is getting pulverized, getting broken up into very small particles. It does go through that initial withering phase, so there's the moisture loss. Humidity and temperature and time are all really important in the withering phase, and it can really vary amongst styles of tea how long you wither for. But the CTC, the leaf is then basically essentially just pulverized, and you're getting the maximum amount of surface area in that leaf, so a really high oxidation. And the oxidation period will last for, I think for our black teas, we do 2 to 4 hours. So once you pulverize the leaf, there's lots of additional enzymatic oxidation happening, and all those flavor compounds and the color compounds that creates the dark tea liquor when you brew tea, black tea. And then there's the orthodox style of black tea where it's more whole leaf, and that's what we're doing. We're doing it all by hand. So we will, for the black tea, we'll pick our tea, it will wither, then we will also put it in this, like a muslin sack, working a pound at a time, get it into very small balls and hand roll it for 30 minutes straight. And then we'll let it sit and oxidize, and then we'll hand roll again for about 45 minutes to an hour we'll roll. And
how many people do you have on your farm doing that portion?
Depends on how much we're doing at any given time.
Okay.
Casey, who's our primary processor right now, it's very hard to do all that hand rolling herself, so she'll often have 2 to 4 people helping her during that hand rolling phase. That's really where we need the mechanization, is especially with the black teas. If you try our whole leaf black tea, the amount of pressure that you can get with the raw hand, even a very, hardworking, strong, feisty Casey, it's exhausting. And you can't really get that high level of oxidation like you would with machinery that gets that pressure, especially related to in comparison to the CTC styles. Because a lot of people in black teas, they're used to the tea bags, and you're putting that black tea in, and it's tiny particles, and it's a very, very dark, strong brew. So the black teas we're making, they're a little lighter oxidized, they're whole leaf, they're a little more delicate. I think they're lovely, I love them. But they're not necessarily what people are used to in tea. So that's the very basic 10-minute tea 101, white tea, green tea, oolongs, black. I'm not even gonna talk about pu'er. It's a whole separate style of tea where the tea is actually fermented. And we're not attempting that at all yet. Yeah.
On the Orthodox, as opposed to the pulverized, you get more caffeine in the pulverized than in the thing?
We have really tried to understand the caffeine compound and how and when it's formed in the tea plant. And there's a lot of conflicting information on the internet. It seems like it's a very variable, from what we understand, it's incredibly variable.
A lot of it's the growing conditions.
Mm-hmm. And the time of year you pick it. And then how you process it. So some green teas can actually have much higher caffeine content than black teas. Or a green tea picked in the spring at a certain different time of year can have a higher caffeine content. So
yeah,
caffeine's not necessarily related to the enzymatic oxidation.
I think the biggest myth is that a lot of people think black teas, oolongs, green teas, that it steps down in caffeine. It's not nearly as neat as that at all. Like you can have a green tea that higher content than black. You can have a black that's higher than the green. And a lot of times heat, too high heat in the processing can destroy some of the caffeine. So it is a heat sensitive compound. And so it's complex, and there's not a unanimous scientific opinion on it, or it's kind of seems like it's being discovered right now exactly which variables affect it.
My doctor told me that teas have more caffeine than coffee.
They can. They're really variable.
On the whole, I think that's not true.
Okay.
When I've seen like average levels, like of a per cup brewed cup, that coffee's still higher than most teas.
And
especially
tea can have. Yeah, there's all these other antioxidants and other compounds in tea that counteract. That's why a lot of people like green teas, because there's theanine, there's these calming compounds that kind of work in tandem with caffeine, and that's a whole other subject area. Yes?
I believe that's what I've heard that as well. Yeah, that's another, I think there is some sort of breakdown over time when they're aged for years or decades even sometimes.
Are you looking into it?
I've been interested, but it's kind of back burner because there's so many other ones it might be interesting to get into and just let sit and age. But yeah, we're trying to kind of perfect the fresher teas first and then maybe move into it.
We have so little tea right now that it feels, I'd be very nervous to start to experiment with pu'er before I learn more. Yeah, so in the last 2 years, our amount of, so perfect segue to the flush. So picking tea. So our picking season lasts from about early May until September. That usually throughout the world, there are specific times of years that tea plantations are picked. The spring flush on all tea farms is the most prized flush of tea because the flavor compounds in the fresh, the new growth, the two leaves and a bud from when the plant comes out of dormancy, there's something about the flavor compounds in that, concentrated in those tips, that's higher than any other time of year in the tea plant. So oftentimes you'll see tea sold as first flush, second flush. Pico is actually a designation of flush. It's not a flavoring like many people think. So we think of our tea as spring flush, summer flush, and fall flush, and we like to make certain styles of tea based on what flush we're picking from. Typically, we see the plants, when they come out of dormancy in the spring, having it tends to be the biggest flush, and you can see you're really only picking, so for the highest quality teas, you're only picking the top two leaves and a bud, and you can really feel the suppleness of the leaf and the delicacy of it. It's really easy to tell the difference if you kind of feel
always has
profile.
A little bud right there growing with it.
Generally, yes.
Yeah.
That's a growth bud.
Yeah.
It's the so it has to have the bud. So you can kind of see these are the plants in April where the new fresh growth is just sort of peeking out above the plant. You can really see it when the light catches it. This is a midsummer flush with a huge amount of tips. Like I was saying earlier, in the last 2 years, we've been managing our plot both for propagation and for commercial production, and they're sort of antithetical management practices because you're trying to get this tall growth to take your cutting, but it means your tea hedge is getting higher and higher over time. And so this year we had to do a pretty deep, severe cuts because we were running the risk of this, essentially when you cut back into the lower wood, you might not have the plant flush back at all, though we have seen it always flush back when we've cut it, but it basically delays your regrowth for many, many, many months, and you don't have as many growing tips when you go, you can just see the amount of branching down here is much less than up here, so a lot of our inner wood in the tea plants was getting, the light restriction was causing all the leaves to drop, and the inner wood was getting very dense and woody and long.
Yeah, this has got kind of a perfect cross section. I cut this at ground height or ground level, and this gives a sense of how it's a little higher than we want right now. This, like, picking at this height's a little high generally.
And it's been up here in the last 3 years.
A little more, as far as hand harvesting, more like waist height. But yeah, like Elizabeth was saying, you can see the light restriction. Like, what you're harvesting is really just the skin, the really, really thin layer on the top and some of the sides of the hedge. And when we're pruning back, like Elizabeth was talking about, we were trying to get kind of below a lot of this, because we're not going in and pruning each plant, which we could in the future, but it's pretty labor intensive. So on a rotational basis, we're going to go in and do kind of a haircut, lopping off where you see this really intensive branching, and get back into this kind of wood, and then take a hit that first year, but then the following year we would be back with a lot of vigorous green growth again.
So the amount of finished tea we were able to pick off of our plot this year was very, very, very small because of that deep pruning. But generally we start picking the first week or two of May. We pick everything by hand, the two leaves and a bud. We're making greens and whites in the spring because we feel like those more delicate styles of tea are going to show off that flavor profile better. And we tend to focus on oolongs and blacks in the midsummer and the later summer. Though we did make some black in the spring, that's really nice too. This year we just started experimenting with picking more of the third, fourth, and fifth leaf to actually do a ground tea, which we're using literally a Cuisinart with a meat grinder attachment. So CTC DIY, just to see, what the flavor profile would be like, and trying to, challenge ourselves to get more yield and really see all the different things that we can make from our plot, maybe doing blends or using it as an iced tea, which we did do some pull through of a big leaf green. So this was 3 summers ago, attempting to get again more of that yield of the lower leaf and seeing, what a big leaf green would be like. And yeah, as a cold brew, it's not terrible. Probably should have brewed it a little less strong. It's a little bit astringent, but it's great if you were mixing with ice and putting a little bit in there. So you're welcome with that, but we are primarily focusing on small amounts of white Japanese style greens with the steaming method, tiny amounts of oolong, and then a whole leaf black tea, and really trying to learn more about the processing technique and the biochemical activity that creates all the flavor profiles, because that's really where the art of tea is. So I can go into lots of depth about that for anyone who's interested later.
Yeah, so thank you, you two. That was fascinating.
Yeah.
Really, there is a ton to learn.